Hi, in this video I'll be showing you the last step of the Colibri VR pipeline, which is rendering. In a previous video, we had captured sample images using a Blender's Suzanne monkey, and then we had processed these input images to obtain a bundle of 3D assets, and these are the assets that we're going to be rendering in this step. So first of all, let's create an empty game object. And this time we'll be adding a rendering component. And like before, we have to select the folder containing our source data, so here Suzanne. And we can see the input camera is appearing, so it's recognized our input data. And using the rendering component, we're going to select a rendering method to render these images in a specific way. The simplest rendering method is textured focal surfaces, and what this is going to do is project each image onto the corresponding focal plane at a given length. So if we render this by clicking play, and we go back to the scene view, we can see that each image is rendered in 3D space by being projected as onto a plane mesh positioned in front of the corresponding camera. And if we increase the focal lengths so as to make these images overlap, we can see that no blending is performed. So we have this Z-fighting because they're all at the same depth. So to improve on this, we can use a different rendering solution, which is called disk-blended focal surfaces. So we're still using the focal surfaces, but this time we'll be using some blending. So I'll decrease the focal length and launch this by clicking play. And this time we have something a little different. So what we see here is that each image is rendered once again, but this time we have these disks appearing. And what these disks are giving a weight to each pixel on the rendered plane based on whether or not the image is relevant for the current viewpoint. So if I move around my camera, we can see that the disks are being changed based on my current viewpoint. And using these kinds of rendering solutions, which are called view-dependent rendering, we can render some interesting specular effects, for example, specular highlights appearing on a shiny material. Let me increase the focal length a bit, so let's put it somewhere around 1. So this is typically what is done for light field rendering when we have a very dense sampling scheme, so a lot of cameras densely packed together. And we can have a bit of a preview of this here, although we only have a few cameras. So by moving around the focal length, so we can see that we can put different objects in the scene in focus by moving around this focal length. And we can also modify the blending angle to make sure it's not too blurry based on the current focal length. And then if we move around using the camera, we'll see that using the camera most relevant for my current viewpoints, this will give the impression that we have a 3D monkey, although we were only using planes, only using images and projecting the corresponding images onto the camera's focal planes. We have this impression that as I move around the monkey's head, it's actually there in 3D space. But this is still quite blurry and we can't be focused everywhere, so we still want to improve on this. And to do that, we can select a last rendering solution, which is disk blended purview meshes. And we can select this option because in the previous step, we had captured some depth information, so one depth map per image. And we had processed this to obtain a set of purview meshes. So if I render this, increase the blending angle and click play. Okay, so once again we have our disks, and this time I'll increase the blending angle, and we can see that now everything is in focus since we're using these the depth information to select the right plane, the right depth to project each part of my geometry. So now if I move around my camera, we'll see that everything is really in focus. I'm seeing the monkey as a 3D object. And once again, we're selecting, so we can see this with the discs, we're selecting the cameras based on the one most relevant for my current viewpoint. So using these methods, we should be able to render some view-dependent effects, such as the specular highlights here on the monkey. So if you look around at this area, you should be seeing that the bright spot changes based on my current viewpoint. Now, of course, this works better when you have a more dense sampling of the images, but it still gives a pretty good idea of what we can achieve with these tools. So that was the last part of our first tutorial, so rendering the bundled assets using the rendering component.